Perfect. So, okay, well, it is my pleasure to introduce you to Patrick Canibel. I've known Patrick for some 20 years by now, no? Is that correct? And so we're both more or less similarly old, but we've been traveling the star formation, turbulence, thermal instability, and other things together. And Patrick is, I have to say, is one of the most influential theorists in the area of star formation today. He has written a very nice review in 2012 on turbulence in molecular clouds. And so Patrick has been working on lots of things, starting with cloud formation. Then he went out to work on the initial mass function. And he has continued to work on that, but he has kept going to smaller and smaller scales, just down to the very process of how the stars accrete their mass through simulations. And I think that's what he's going to talk to us about. So, Patrick, I'm very glad to have you here, and please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much, Enrique. So it's a great pleasure to speak in Morelia and other place, if I understood. There are three institutes here. First, I would like to say, do not hesitate to interrupt me and ask questions during the talk, because it will give me the impression that I'm not speaking, you see, just in front of my computer or by myself. So it makes the process, even for me, more interactive, and because I do not have the feedback that you usually got when you speak in front of an audience. So please do so. And then from time to time, I will actually stop and to ask you whether the flow is all right and so on. Okay. So today I'm going to discuss the issue of the stellar initial mass function. That's a work which I've been working on with Gilles Chabrier for years, and during the PhD of my former student Yuanning Li, who is now permanent in Taiwan, and also with Evan Tormozzi. Okay. Oops. Yes, okay. So I start with these broad introductions. So the star formation and the interstellar cycle is certainly a key step of our universe, because it somehow made the connections between the large scales, so say the galaxy clusters and so on, and the planets. Okay, so the two scales are kind of connected to each other by this series of complex nonlinear steps. So to make it short, say we have galaxies, and inside galaxies we find molecular clouds. So those entities have, say, a typical mass on the order of 100,000 solar mass or so, and the size of a few hundreds of light years. Inside molecular clouds, one observes those so-called dense cores, which I sometimes call them baby stars. The stars, the baby stars, unlike the human baby, they are big. The human baby are small, but baby stars are big because they are, you see, on the process of collapsing. So those are regions where gravity has already been sort of taking over and is really conducting these collapse or implosions. At the very center of the dense cores, the stars will eventually form, and around the stars, accretion disks, which form because of the conservation of angular momentum, and that's those accretion disks are the cradle of planets. So the connection between, say, the large scales and the small scales really occurs through this chain of complex processes, which to which questions can be assigned, fundamental questions in terms of star formation and in the history of the universe. So first, there is a question of the star formation rate and efficiency. So at which timescale the gas is converted into stars. And of course, there is a debate, but probably if one should place the steps which kind of control the star formation rate, it's probably somewhat here, okay? Between, slightly before the molecular clouds formation. I mean, there may be controversy, but that's the way I would place it. Then, of course, that will be the goal of the talk today, the origin of the stellar initial mass functions, which is probably taking place from the molecular clouds actually to the star itself. But as we will discuss, it's another fundamental issue. Then, of course, finally, the protostars and the binarity, the protoplanetary disks are taking place also in this cycle. And one needs actually to close the loop. And there is a feedback from the stars and to the galaxy, which, the problem was already difficult in this stage because there is always almost 10 orders of magnitude in terms of scales, but now we have closed the loop, so there is not only a direct cascade, but also this invert cascade, and somehow, because the stars is having a strong influence on the galaxy itself, the radius of the star and the radius of the galaxy are kind of coupled together, and once again they have a size ratio which is more than 10 orders of magnitude large. So it's an enormous scale connectivity, which makes the problem really difficult. Right. Okay. So now getting more specific, so to this initial mass function. So the initial mass functions, I guess probably most of you are familiar with it, but maybe not all of you. So this is essentially the distribution of mass, of stellar masses. So if I take this graph here, I have the stellar mass in the X, in the axis, and the number of stars per logarithmic bin in the Y axis. So typically, this initial mass function has a peak, meaning that the most likely mass of a star, at least in this logarithmic bin, on the order of 0.3 solar mass or so. Then there is something which is in between a log normal distribution and a power law with a typical exponent, which is known since the Salpeter paper in 55, which is supposed to be minus 1.3. And then at smaller mass in the Brown-Dwarf regime, there is a kind of sharp cutoff again. So here we have real data, and we see the distribution for a series of clusters, of Young stellar clusters. What is striking is that when you go from cluster to cluster, you see essentially the same distribution. I mean, there are statistical variation and so on, but it seems that, broadly speaking, it's kind of compatible with one distribution, with this one. So it seems that this initial mass function is kind of universal. I mean, nowadays there are some evidence for some variation, particularly in early type galaxies. But this is still something which is explored at the moment. And even if it's confirmed, still one could naively expect more variation when one goes from one place to another. I mean, in the Milky Way or from one molecular cloud to another, we know that the density may vary a lot, as well as other properties of the gas. So why don't we see more variations? That's one problem. And maybe I should have emphasized this more, but of course the initial mass function is a very important quantities to understand the history of the universe, because obviously stars are producing the heavy elements. They are also producing the feedback I was describing before, and they host planets. And we know that the properties of stars heavily depends on their mass. So these initial mass functions, for these reasons, appears in many, many problems in astrophysics because of the importance of stars. So to come back to the shape of the IMF, which is represented here, I mean, the subject of the talk will be of course understanding its physical origin, but for now we can notice something here, which is kind of power law or log normalish shape. So this sounds like a scale-free process, okay? And something like gravity or turbulence, they are scale-free process, and so this would sound, I mean, not unexpected to have something which is a power law. I mean, we know, for example, that turbulence produces a lot of power law. And then there is a peak, and the peak somehow is a characteristic mass. So my point of view during the talk, as you will see, will be that, okay, there is indeed a scale-free process or the combination of scale-free process. And then there is a characteristic mass which cannot stop the scale-free process, okay? So that's what I will try to describe during the talk. Okay, so I'm, okay, right. So the plan of the presentation will be as follows. First, I will discuss a bit some observation and theories, and then I will follow an approach that we can call brute force, which is trying to really do the connection between the kind of kiloparsecs up to the scale of the cores when the IMF could take place. So the idea here is to try to take most processes into account and hoping to get the IMF. And as you will see, I will kind of fail, and this will push me toward a new strategy, which would be essentially coming back to a single cloud and trying to change all parameter which we believe is relevant in this context, to try to identify which one is really the important one and what one does, how the different parameters modify the mass function. And I will finish with some analytical modeling, if I have the time, to try to understand the main, most important feature that has been identified here. Okay. And I will just very briefly allude to some full gradative transfer modeling after this series of numerical experiments. Right, so let me start with the first part. So I already discussed the initial mass functions, which is again shown here, two distribution, the Chabrier one and the Groupa one. And so I already introduced the cores, which are the sort of dense entities seen in molecular clouds, where gravity has already been taken over. And making, of course, the connection between the cores and stars is tempting, because the cores are the last coherent entities somehow in which stars form. So whether they could be the mass reservoir which out of which the stars eventually build their mass, of course, is very tempting. And it turns out that recent observations, particularly obtained with the Herschel telescopes, have shown that the core mass function has a shape which turns out to be similar with the initial mass functions, with maybe similar mass, similar shape at large mass, and a peak. Except that the peak is not at the right place, it's shifted by at least a factor of 3-ish, which is possibly interpreted as an efficiency. Okay. So this approach has been suggesting that in order to understand the initial mass functions, what we need to understand the core mass function. And therefore, one needs to do a kind of statistical counting to estimate the mass spectrum of the density fluctuation. So something similar has been done in cosmology like 30 or 40 years ago now, the famous Press and Schechter analysis, which has been very successful. So the idea is that you have fluctuations, primordial fluctuations in the density, which will collapse a bit faster because they are denser. And there is a kind of mapping between those density fluctuation and the mass spectra of the dark matter halos. So similar approach has been followed by so in a series of papers with different assumptions and so on. But so essentially, one assumes that the density probability distribution function is log normal. So this would replace the density fluctuations of the Gaussian density fluctuation of the assume for the primordial fluctuations. Then those fluctuations, they not only have a probability density function, they also have a power spectrum, which come from turbulence, okay? And then instead of considering the structures which have the time to have collapses today, one needs to consider the ones which are self-gravitating, meaning that gravity is dominating over the other type of support. And so this is a bit of math just to illustrate what is behind. So essentially, we will select the structures which are dominated by gravity. So this is simply the Bayer theorem, which should not be understood in terms of a static equilibrium picture, but more than you have a dynamically evolving piece of fluids, and at some stage, if gravity is sufficiently dominant locally, okay, the piece of fluids get trapped by some gravity and then it collapses. So you have on one hand, so in this equation, so gravity, and then other support like the thermal support, which if you are as thermal is does not depend on scale, and then there is a kinetic support, so the turbulence, which is scale dependent. And so the physical picture is that if turbulence is too strong, okay, then the piece of fluid gets sheared apart and gravity is not able to maintain. So from these simple equations, one can obtain a mass, which essentially is something like a Jeans mass, which depends on scale. So for a given scale, okay, the mass of the fluid, when you smooth the fluid at the scale R, must be at least equal to the mass which is written here, this one, to be unstable. Okay, if the mass is below this one at this scale, it's not unstable at this scale. And you can equivalently write density by, so this is the log of the density by simply dividing this by R to the 3 and taking the log. So once you get this, the idea is that at a given scale, okay, you have density and a mass. So if you now come back to the PDF, the density PDF, and we have one example here, okay? So this is the log of the density and this is the PDF. So you know, if I select a density, say this one, okay, I can integrate my PDF like this, okay? And then I will know what fraction of the gas is above this density. But from the formula, this one, I know that at a given scale, I have now an unstable density, which comes again from my Weyl theorem. So it means that for all scale, I have a density. So for all scale, I can say, okay, if this is scale R1, the unstable gas at this scale is this one. If this is scale R2, this is this one. Scale R3, this one. Okay. So that all scale, I know exactly the fraction of the gas which is unstable. So now I can just say, well, okay, for a given scale, I know a mass, which is unstable, and I know a density. So I know a fraction of gas. So I can simply write for all scale that my fraction of mass, which is written here. So this equation is just the integration from a specific density unstable at a scale R. So this integral, which does this, okay. So this mass has to be equal to the sum of the mass of the structures which are smaller than my unstable mass here. Okay? So I'm writing that the density, the sum of this density, of the unstable density, is equal to the sum of all the mass below M. So that's where the mass spectrum comes from. And because R, the scale, is a continuous parameter, I can take the derivative of this equation, which is simply a mass balance with respect to the scale. I divide it, so I derive it with respect to scale, and then I obtain a mass spectrum, this one. So when I do that, I can make an analytical prediction. So this is an analytical prediction here. And for a specific choice, I will come back to that later, of density and of Mach numbers. And this is the Chabrier IMF. So you see, you can produce a mass spectrum which has a shape that is really close to the initial mass function. And comparisons with supersonic, simulation that include supersonic turbulence, but here no subgravity, and that's something I will discuss later, have been made, and you see you can obtain a quite good, I mean, reasonable agreement, not perfect, but still quite reasonable. That's a paper from Schmidt. So this is encouraging. Okay. However, things are more complicated than that. In particular, because this approach that I just described, which is the simplest one, is for isothermal gas, which means that there is no preferred, there is no scale. I mean, in terms, when you deal with isothermal gas, you can rescale your whole problem, meaning choosing the density and then adjusting the spatial scale, and that will work finely. Which means that the peak here depends on the assumptions for the density. So in those simulations, for example, by Gong and Ostrager, but there may be many others, including by the group of Enrique and Javier. So the peak is not well defined because, once again, there is not a physical scale in an isothermal simulation. And you have an illustration of this problem also here. When you check the Mach number, you see the peak will move. So from this preliminary work, I would say, the slope of the IMF seems to be robust. And indeed, I haven't the time to go in detail, but the exponent of the slope is predicted, and it's a direct consequence of gravity and turbulent support, which enters in the real theorem. So this is kind of, it's a scale-free process, so you don't need a typical mass, Cartesian mass, but the peak, not. So the peak is an issue. So to try to tackle these questions, what one needs now to really bring back the physics of the ISM, which includes things like the cooling, of course, of the gas, but also I would say more generally, the structure of the galaxy and so on. So you have here a simulations of a shrink of galaxy. So this is one kiloparsec. And so in this simulation, you have MHD with the interstellar cooling. You have same gravity, of course. You have supernova explosions. You have the stratification. Okay. So all, maybe not all, but many of the physical processes that we think are important in the interstellar medium. So the goal now is to say, okay, maybe running this kind of simulation with enough resolution will allow us to find a peak in the core mass functions that could maybe produce then the core mass function and produce the initial mass function. And maybe this peak, we can then identify which mechanisms is at play behind. So to do this, the idea is to zoom on one of those initial conditions, to use those simulations as initial conditions, adding, so this is now an edge, this is now a view which is seen edge on like this. And the idea is to zoom on a specific part using an active mesh refinement code, Ramses. Adding so 9 more AMR level, so to go from typically so the few hundred parsecs, which is the size under which we perform the large level of zoom, up to numerical resolution of about a few 10 to the minus 3 parsec, which gives an effective spatial resolution roughly 5 or 10 times this value, so approaching the 0.1 parsec, which is typically the scale of the core. So in the simulation, the hope is that we can describe the core themselves, not the internal detail of the cores, but the core themselves. So this is the zoom that I'm presenting here, and all the small points that you see, they are cores, and they are typically resolved by like 5 or 10 grid points. Okay, so in this approach, again, the goal is to try to go from this full sort of intermediate galactic scale, where we don't make any strong prescription on a specific cloud in terms of density, Mach number, or so on. Things are set consistently through the stratification and the cooling and the feedback. And then we go self-consistently up to the cores. So once you do that, you can extract the cores and you can look at the core mass function. So this is one example here. So you have to go to use an algorithm to identify the cores and to select the ones which are self-gravitating. So here I'm selecting the ones which are magnetically supercritical and here the one which are thermally supercritical. So I mean, you see the two distributions are not very different. And so the good news is that we find a slope which, so this actually is Salpeter, which is, I would say, compatible with Salpeter, I mean, close to what is observed. There is a peak. You see the peak is a bit at higher mass. And of course, when you are doing, numerical simulation, the first things to do is to understand the effect of your resolution. And so this, what is done here, changing the maximum level of resolution, so going from coarse to finer resolution, unfortunately, or I don't know whether it's unfortunate, it is how it is, you see that the peak shifts toward smaller and smaller mass. Meaning that in those simulations, also most of the physics of the galaxy, of the interstellar gas is actually taken into account, the peak of the distribution is numerical. It's controlled by the resolution itself. So this means that so far, we don't have in this context, we don't succeed to have in this context, a robust description of the CMF and therefore probably not of the IMF as well. So the standard ISM physics does not seem to provide a robust peak. It's for the slope is better, but that was already the case if you remember from the purely isothermal approach where the slope is okay, but the peak was not because there is not a characteristic peak. If you even if you go introduce all this complicated ISM physics with the cooling, say the magnetic field, the stratification, and so on, still you don't get a robust peak. So it means that something else probably is setting it, and the goal now is to try to understand what may be going on. I would like to pause for a sec here. Is the flow okay? Do you have questions? Is everything all right for your side?
Okay with me.
Okay, good. Okay. So, as I said, we are now changing strategy and changing scale.
Or perhaps, Patrick, maybe this is the time to ask you a question about the previous part. No?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Could you show the CMFs, this one. Mm-hmm. So the next one, the one where you have this, the resolution analysis. Yes. So my question here is, how do you define the course in these higher resolution simulations? I think that's the thing. And that might be related to something you said at the beginning. You said that the cores are supposedly the last coherent structures before forming a star. But actually, for example, people like Aina and her collaborators look at the fragmentation within the cores. So it might as well be a resolution-dependent definition. And so in that sense, I am not that surprised that the core mass function does depend on resolution, no? So how do you define the cores?
Yeah, so—
What about the fragments in the cores?
Right, so we define them by using this sort of HOP method, which has been developed in cosmology. Essentially, you identify the algorithms, look for the local density maximum, and then it follows the density, okay? So up to the point where density starts decreasing, so finding the saddle point, so to speak. Okay? And this is defined as the core, or as core candidate. And then you have to verify that to make a bit like observer, in a sense, like the cores are really self-gravitating. So this is a more 3D theoretician definition. I'm now conducting a work in parallel with Fabien Louvet and Frédéric Mott, where we now extract the cores both in the simulation and in the observation, exactly as observer do. Okay, and we find exactly the same effect, both from the real simulation, the real data and the simulation. Both for the two set of data, we find exactly the same effect. The core mass functions depends a lot on your resolution. So if you take your observational data and you smooth them out by, say, a factor 2 or more, you perform your core extractions in the smooth data or in the original data, and you find the peak that's not at the same place.
Okay.
So, and that's true for, as I said, the algorithms that observer use and the one that I've been using as well.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, maybe at the end I'll ask some more.
Okay. Right, thanks for the feedback at least. Okay, so, I was going to this second part. So, in parallel to what I was doing, I mean, many people have been studying the collapse of a single cloud. For example, Javier has been doing this with Lee Hartman for years. And with various success. So this is work by Matthew Bates, where in the first paper, the peak was occurring at smaller scales. Then later, when the physics included relative transfer, the peak was, I mean, at 0.3 solar mass, like in reality. I would say that this is too flat, and that's something I would come back to later. And I think it's a bit of a general trend. That's simulation by Girishidis. So first, you see the peak is at small, too small mass, but this purely at the thermal, and that's a bit too flat. Okay, and that's by Javier. I think the slope is 1, so 1, while the IMF is 1.3. I would say there is a general trend that maybe those simulations produce something too flat. But I mean, still there is a power law and there is a peak. And so the idea now is to decipher this in detail and to try to kind of do a systematic investigation of what is doing what here. So to do this, I will present now a series of simulations. So 1,000 solar mass clouds with essentially a uniform density almost profile initially. Turbulence is added, so it's not generated self-consistently like in the first set of data of simulation I was presenting. And then in the first series of simulation, there is importantly an equation of state as well. So the gas at some density goes from isothermal to adiabatic. So I'm plotting here with my hand the temperature. So from at low density, I mean low means smaller than 10 to the 10. So it's quite still high, but it's low with the density at which it becomes adiabatic. So the gas is isothermal because the dust is responsible of the cooling and can radiate away the PdV work induced by gravity. But once the density is so strong that the dust becomes opaque to its own radiation, the radiation is trapped, and therefore the gas cannot radiate away, and so the effective equation of states becomes more adiabatic. So that's something that will be important later. So we employ sync particles, which are nothing but subgrid model for stars. So the resolution we will go, the maximum is almost to 2 AU. Huh? So notice that before I was tracking the cores. So the cores, I went to resolution of a few thousand AU or 100 AU, 1,000 AU say. Here we now really go much further into scale and reaching, as I said, almost AU scale. Okay, and so here, the idea is to change all of that. So to change initial conditions, but also the equation of state and make our resolutions. So that's a kind of example of the simulation we will produce. So those are two time steps. So initially, there are no stars, and then stars start forming, and at the end, there are many. So the red points are the sync particles. There are stars, so you see this filament forms under the influence, the joint influence of compressive turbulence and gravity and semi-gravity. And so when you reach some kind of density threshold, the sink is introduced, the sink particles, and the sinks will accrete energy, will accrete mass a bit like stars would. So the sink particles, they are subgrid modeling of stars, because of course going up to the stars scale would be far too demanding. So there is no hope to do that even with modern computers for such large scales. And so those are zoom, which show a bit of more details, the gas and the sink particles, which again are the red point. Okay, so the first thing we will do is vary the density of those clouds in a systematic way. So those are four simulations. So this is low density and this is high density, so essentially going in that direction. For each simulation, what you have here is the log of the mass, and the number of stars per logarithmic mean. And those various lines, they correspond to various times. So this is a time evolution. And they correspond also to the mass, the total mass, which has been accreted into the thin particles. So we, as I said, when we go from here to here, we change the initial density of the clouds by almost 4 orders of magnitude. So the radius of the clouds change, but the initial ratio of turbulence energy over gravitational energy does not. So this is this parameter is fixed constant. But because you change the density, you can also it means you change the thermal energy. So by doing so, what is changing here in those series of simulations is the Mach number. So it means that as I go from this simulation to this one, the Mach number will change by almost a factor of 10 initially. Okay. So it means that the ratio of turbulent over thermal energy is increasing as I go from here to here. And just for you to remember, in the one of the first equations I show, which was the Weyl theorem decide which mass is unstable at the scale R, there are two supports. There is a thermal support and there is a turbulent support. So in this picture, okay, if I have this picture in mind, when I go from this simulation to this one, okay, I'm giving more and more weight to the turbulent support compared to the thermal support. Okay. Right. So in the first simulation, obviously you don't form something which looks like the IMF. It is completely flat. Okay, the mass spectrum is flat, m to the zero. If you go, if you increase the density by a factor 10-ish, then you start forming something which has a power law, okay, and a peak. And the power law is similar to the one inferred, for example, by Ravier or by Girichidis. It's a bit shallower than Salpeter. It's between -3/4 and -1. Typically, it's not -1.3. I like -3/4 because later I will have a theory which predicts this exponent. And it seems to be -3/4 is actually a good fit. Importantly enough, as you see, I plotted with this red line. This is the peak position. So once you reach this density, if you go to higher density, you see the peak does not vary with density anymore. Also, if I go from this simulation to this one, the mean density still changed by 3 orders of magnitude almost. Still, the peak is at the same place. Okay? So from here we learn two things. First, if density is very small, then I don't get something like the IMF, is m to the zero. Maybe actually some similarity with POP3 IMF, but that's another debate. At higher density, we have a peak around 0.1 solar mass or so, with at higher mass, a mass spectrum with an exponent of -3/4 or -1, say around that. Okay. And first conclusion is that the peak of the IMF does not seem to depend on the mean genes mass. Because again, if I go from here to here, I don't see any big variations. And also, one should remember that the genes mass is not something which is well defined, because in a density in the cloud, there is a continuous distribution of density. So the mean density is something well defined, but why should it be the mean density so important? I have a distribution of density. Okay, second, I will change the turbulence. So again, changing the turbulence by, here in this case, a factor about 15 actually, from 0.1 to 1.5. And the story is a bit similar than for density. Initially, I have something which is a bit flat and which is not really structured. But as long as I have some turbulence, like 0.3 in terms of this real number, I got a mass spectrum with a peak, again, more or less at the same position than before. And again, if I increase the turbulence from, say, 0.3 to 1.5, the effect on the mass spectrum is really big. Okay, I can do the same with the magnetic field, but I think I'm running a bit out of time. So the bottom, the simple message is it's not so important for now. Okay. What is of course very important is the dependence and the resolution, because we saw for the first type of simulation that actually it was very important. So here I have two sets of simulation. The one I've been presented so far are those ones. So they have what I call the standard equation of state with the transition from isothermal to adiabatic. If I start with a purely isothermal set of simulation and I crank up the resolution from 17 to 4 AU, okay, from this line, here you see that as you increase the resolution, the peak of your distribution go to smaller values. Okay, so the peak shift towards smaller values. So it means that what was happening before reproduce again. The peak is resolution dependent. If I do the same with my standard equation of state, well, this time the story is different. The peak does not change, does not vary with resolution. If I change the resolution by a factor 4, the peak stays at the same place. Okay. Now I have changed the density, I have changed the turbulence and the resolution, and I always find that in some range, the peak is always at the same place. So the very last parameters which may control this peak, it's not initial conditions, it's not the Meckel scheme, so it has to be the thermodynamics. So let's do that. And so here I'm changing for the same parameter. Once again, we have an equation of states which go from isothermal to adiabatic, and we can think to two parameters. First, there is the density at which the transition occurs. So physically, it should be a few 10 to the 10. That's coming from the property of dust. But of course, numerically, you can do whatever you want to understand the physics. You can modify it. Okay. And second, there is the value when you go from isothermal to adiabatic. Can change the gamma. So gamma should be 5/3 and up to the point where the rotational level of the H2 molecule get excited, then you'd start having something which is more like 7/5, but initially it's 5/3. So again, you can explore and see what happens if you take, say, 5/3 or 4/3. And 4/3, of course, is the critical exponent for gravity. So here you have three simulations where so gamma is fixed to 5/3, so this gamma here, okay, but I change the adiabatic density from 10 to the 10, 3 10 to the 9, 10 to the 9, so changing this. So it means that the transition between isothermal and adiabatic occurs at lower density. And so in this case, okay, you clearly see from 10 to the 10, 3 10 to the 9, 10 to 9, that the transition, so the peak, occurs at larger and larger mass. So clearly the peak is directly connected to the equation of state. And if you do the same, but this time with gamma equal 4/3, again changing the adiabatic density, then this time you see that it has a very, very weak impact. So it means somehow it's a combination of all this equation of state. And to try to be more specific, we introduce the notions of the so-called first Larsen core. So this first Larsen core occurs because precisely you have this transition between the isothermal regime and the adiabatic regime. essentially, when the equation of state become adiabatic, some Hall support becomes dominant over gravity. It means that the collapse is stopped. The cloud, the isothermal cloud is collapsing. Then equation of state change, thermal pressure wins, gravity is stopped. Okay, so you start piling matters, okay, in this central core, up to the point where the temperature, the central temperature, becomes high enough, and then you start dissociating the H2 molecules. Okay, and then you start to go to the second phase, the second collapse, and to form eventually the stars. But so the mass of the first Larsen core is something which can be computed from elementary hydrodynamical simulations. So this is what we have been doing here. And so that's the density profile that you get from the different equation of state we have been exploring. So you get an endostatic object and a mass, which you can see here. This is the radius, and as a function, this is the mass profile, and you see you converge toward a plateau, and that's the mass of your first Larsen core. So for each equation of state, you can associate a mass. And so now you can plot the peak that we have in the simulation. So essentially those values here, okay? Those values. And you can plot this peak, which is measured in the simulation, as a function of the mass of the first Larsen core, which is associated to the equation of state that has been used. So for all equation of state, so this one, we can compute the mass. And we can then plot this mass as a function of this one. Okay? So that's what is done here. And then you see a very clear correlation between the two. So essentially, the peak, the mass of the peak, is proportional to the mass of the Larsen core. But there is a factor 10 between the two. So the physics that we kind of infer is essentially that as the collapse proceeds, it triggers the local density enhancement, which eventually becomes adiabatic. When it becomes adiabatic, the process of collapsing stops, mass piles up, okay? And then finally, the collapse restarts because of the physics of the H2 molecules, or because we introduce a thing particle in our case, but more or less when the H2 molecules would dissociate. So what we propose, or what we observe, is that the peak, this produces a peak in the distributions with this factor 10. So it's like mass accumulates. And this is this mass accumulation which is important for to producing the peak. Okay, so what we learned so far is the mass spectrum would present two behavioral, either zero, which seems to be a bit, let's say, marginal, or -3, -4, -1, which seems to be more typical. So a self-similar regime, which I would say is due to isothermal pressure and gravity turbulence. And then a robust peak, robust because it does not depend on resolution. And we understand what control it. This is the equation of state, the thermodynamics, which typically produce 10 times the mass of the Larsen core. And I remind you, or maybe I should have said earlier, that typically the mass of the Larsen core is precisely 3×10⁻²² solar mass. So if you multiply this 3×10⁻²² solar mass by 10, then you get 0.3 solar mass, which is the peak of the N. So this theory is appealing, okay, because it produces the peak at the right value, and because it is robust. So it has it rings a bell with respect to the universality, the fact that the peak of the MF seems to be more or less almost always the same. And that not depend on the large-scale conditions, density, and so on. Okay, so I have this analytical modeling, but I see that time is running. So I don't know how much time you want me to spend on that.
So usually we end at around 10 before 1. If you have maybe 2 or 3 minutes, you could possibly do that. But otherwise,
okay. Say, no. Right. Okay. So maybe I will be very fast then, just to give a flavor. So yeah. Okay. The idea is that so those effects seems to be very important for the MF. So now we need to have some kind of better understanding of the physical origin. So the idea is that I can now come back to my initial formula, which, if you remind, relied the density distribution to the mass spectrum. But with an important difference, initially I've been assuming that the molecular clouds, the density distribution is log normal. But in a collapsing cloud, actually, it's not log normal. We have a power law. It's log normal in the outer part, but in the inner part, it's more a power law with a rho proportion to minus 1.5. And so if we apply the same formalisms, but instead of the log normal, we pick up this PDF, we can do the mass again. And indeed, we find that if Samar supports dominates, which, if we remind you, corresponds to the first simulation, the lowest density I was showing, then we indeed predict that the mass spectra should be flat, M to the zero. And if turbulence support dominates, then we find something which is more minus three fourths. So this is in good agreement with the result of the simulation. And actually, if you compare the analytical model with the mass spectrum observed, we can reproduce many of the behavior. This I think I will skip. Then the second point is the peak. So as I said, the important point is that we have this factor of 10 between the mass of the first Larsen core and the peak of the IMF. So how do you produce a factor 10? So the idea is the following. When you first form a star like this one, okay, which is the very inner core that forms, it is surrounded by an envelope. Okay, you have gas falling into this envelope. Okay, and so this somehow there is a tendency from this envelope, or there may be a tendency from this envelope to fragment and to find new objects. So because this envelope, which is collapsing, it has very high density. So it could easily form other stars. But the point is that this star is a point mass, and it induces tidal forces on its environment, because there is one over R square gravitational force, and that we know that this force actually has a very strong tidal force, meaning that it tends to shield out a fragment like this. So what we argue, and we have been doing even some analytical modeling for that, is that this effect kind of forbid or make much more complicated for a new fragment to form in the immediate vicinity of a nascent star, because there are strong tidal forces here. So to do this, we have computed the Weyl theorems, taking into account the tidal force around the star. And we have done a kind of statistical analysis where, again, using the PDF, we can compute the probability to find a new self-gravitating object at a given distance of the star, taking into account the fluctuation, the density fluctuation, and the stabilization induced by the tidal forces. Okay. And so, in this paper here, actually, we have an analytical modeling for that, which predicts a peak, typically at 10 times the mass of the first Larsen core. So that's the best. That's the best theory we could come with so far. But it seems to be encouraging, I would say. Okay, and maybe just in a few secs, we are now going to doing to a set of simulations with full relative transfer modeling, because instead of using the equation of states going from isothermal to adiabatic, really computing how much energy is radiated away and how the gas is heated and so far. So that's what I'm doing at the moment. I'm fighting with the accretion luminosity, which is supposed to be released when the stars form. And this is connected to an old problem now on which, for example, Lee Hartman has been working a lot, which is the so-called apparent luminosity being 10 times lower than this value here. So there may be some physics to be understood here, exactly how this energy is radiated away and whether it can hit the gas and so on. So that's what I'm doing at the moment. I hope to be able to publish papers in this area in the coming months or so. Okay. So here is my conclusion. So during the collapse of a massive of clouds, we can form something which has the flavor of the IMF, but is a bit too shallow. That's something important. For now, in this context, the mass spectrum is not minus 1.3, is more 1 or so. The peak is robustly predicted to be 10 times the mass of the first Larsen core. Well, that's encouraging because it really provides the physical origin of the and simple origin of this peak. So that's I would say the open questions or proposition at the moment. So the universality could come from the fact that this is local physics for the peak. Local meaning something which takes place at 100 AU ish. And does not so depends on what's happened on the larger scales. It's all local. And this needs to be clarified. My impression is that there are two regimes. One, that typical ISM calculations are reasonably successful to reproduce, I would say, with a slope close to Salpeter values. And one which is a bit maybe too shallow and that we find in those collapse calculations. So I thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Patrick. This is a very nice talk. We have time for a couple of questions. So let's see some hands. Okay. All right, Javier, go ahead.
So thank you, Patrick, for the interesting and nice talk. I have many questions. But maybe the easiest one or the first one is you argue that the peak of the IMF is due to the equation of state, but then you argue that it could be also due to tidal forces. So I didn't get, is it because of tidal forces? It's just an independent?
No. The tidal forces makes the factor 10.
Yeah, but there is no equation of state there.
No, it's 10 times the equation of state in the mass of the first Larsen core. So the mass of the Larsen core is there. And then on top of that, you have the factor 10, which is due to the tidal force.
Okay, I see. Okay, if there are no more questions, I can continue with different questions.
We have at least one more person, so I'll come back to you. Rosa, go ahead.
Okay, hi, very nice talk. I have a couple of questions, but I hope they're short. One is I got confused about what you said about the data. So if the peak in the data is also depends on resolution, how do you go about that? And the other question is if you have been able to look into the maximum mass, if the maximum mass is also set by, it's statistical or set by some kind of physics?
Okay, so regarding the data, what I said, the density dependence is for the cores actually. I mean, for the IMF itself, you just count the stars. So here there is no issue with resolution. I mean, there could be, I mean, issue with the binarity and so on, of course, but it's just counting the stars. So once you solve them, I mean, that's fine. The problem is when you make the assumption that the core mass function and the initial mass function are linked to each other, then you have to go into what Enrique asked, what is a core? And as we know, it's something which is not terribly well defined. And that's where the issue of numerical resolution may come. So for now, I've been believing for years, actually, that the core mass function was setting the initial mass function. Now I think that maybe this is true for the slope, but I must say in the simulation I have doubt on the existence of a peak, but I must also say that I have started having doubt for the observation as well. Because I'm working with observer now, and I see that when you smooth the observation and you redo your extraction, you find a different world. So to me, it's something that mathematically is not stable.
Okay, and about the maximum mass?
Okay, so that's not something I've been doing in great detail. I mean, the typical stars, the maximum mass of the stars we find in this type of simulation the second type where things are really well resolved, it's on the order of 10 solar masses-ish. I think to form a very big star, like 100 solar mass, you probably need to deal with a much massive, much more massive cores or clump. And therefore, if you want to resolve simultaneously the large scales that you need to describe this massive clump and the detail of the small scales, it's more demanding. So my best guess is that it's more a statistical cut. I don't see a very strong reasons for which there would be a physical process, unless it's something which has to do with the stellar physics itself. So we know that those stars, they live very short. But so the team, for example, which is doing this, like the team of Rolf Kuiper, where they concentrate on forming one massive star, essentially they would find that the mass of the most massive, of the most massive stars, is kind of proportional to the mass of the initial clump and the degree of compactness. So to me, there is no demonstration yet that there is a maximum mass coming from the physical processes. So yeah, my current understanding is this statistical cut.
Okay, thank you.
So it is 10 past the hour. What I'm going to do, I know that Javier has more questions and Enrique also has his hand up. What I suggested, we thank the speaker and then we can continue the discussion again. So thank you very much, Patrick.
Thank you for your.